Intel is launching new desktop CPUs today, so here's my review of the flagship Core i9-14900K. There are two ways to view this launch, I think. The way Intel would prefer you to think about it is to consider that these are 14th gen CPUs, and that means they are newer and better than the previous generation because 14 is obviously a higher number than 13, so take my money, Intel, and let's all get ready to upgrade. The other, much more accurate way would be to consider the code name for this lineup, Raptor Lake Refresh, and to remind yourself that the two most significant things that typically make for faster CPUs, which are a manufacturing process node shrink and or newly designed microarchitecture, are notably absent from this launch, and what we're really looking at are 13th gen CPUs with some small increases to clock speeds, apart from the 14700K, which actually does have four more E-cores than the 13700K, but Intel seems to have an aversion to sampling the 700 tier chip, so I have nothing to report on that one at this time. But what Intel would really like to be able to say is that they once again have the fastest CPU for PC gaming, and so I'll be comparing the 14900K to their previous contender for that crown, the 13900K, as well as AMD's Ryzen 9 7950X3D.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Micro Center. This is one of my favorite places to buy PC parts. So if you're building or upgrading your PC, I highly recommend making your way down to one of their 25 retail stores in the US. They have consistently competitive prices and an excellent selection of PC hardware and other tech goodies. And they have a custom PC builder on the Micro Center website. Use it to spec out your rig and it will show you parts in store at your nearest location while ensuring compatibility. Then you can pick up in store or have their pros assemble it for you. So click the sponsor link in the description to find a Micro Center near you. Okay, I'll be honest. The only thing I find refreshing about this launch is the fact that since we're not dealing with new architecture or anything, I can dispense with the explainer part of the video and get right into the testing setup and benchmarks. I have a set of compute tests, as well as gaming tests, run at 1080p and 4K. 1080 because lower resolutions are typically more CPU bound and will demonstrate performance differences between the CPUs more clearly, and because high refresh rate 1080 gaming is definitely a thing as well, and 4K, because it's much more likely that someone with this setup, which includes an RTX 4090, would be running a higher resolution monitor, and even though 4K tests are more GPU bound, I wanted to provide anyone who is already running some of these high-end hardware configurations an idea of what the performance uplift would actually be if they upgraded. So here are the stats and specs for the three CPUs I'm testing today. You are probably familiar with much of this information, but do note that apart from the max boost clock, the specs between the 13900K and 14900K are pretty much identical. The 14th gen CPUs are said to support higher DDR5 speeds, up to 8,000 megatransfers per second, and they now have per-core throttling, which is nice, I suppose, but personally, I'd prefer a CPU that can just maintain reasonable temperatures, especially with a $200 plus 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler, instead of hitting 90 to 100C, as the 14900K does regularly, causing it to require throttling as it seeks to output maximum performance. But the same could be said for AMD's 7950X, to be fair. The price listing here is also an estimate, as Intel still only provides tray pricing, that's cost per 1,000 units, in their press briefings rather than an MSRP. The tray price is $590 for the 14900K, so I'm going with a conservative $600 here, although we'll probably see retailers putting them up for $600 to $650. The 13900K can be found for $550 as of this week, and the 7950X3D is going for about $650 to $670. Here's a look at my test bed setups. For memory, I am using two 32GB G-Skill DDR5 kits, a Trident Z5 Neo kit with Expo settings for AM5, and their closest equivalent XMP settings kit for Intel, which is a Trident Z5 RGB kit. Both are rated for DDR5 6000 speed and CL30 timings. For the GPU, we're going with the fastest one currently available, which is the RTX 4090, represented by the Founders Edition from NVIDIA. And for the CPU cooler, we have a 360mm AIO, the Corsair H150i Elite LCD. The systems were set up in open test beds with radiator fans pushing air across the motherboard CPU socket and VRMs for consistency. I'm running clean installations of Windows 11 22H2, which does include some security updates which reduce performance slightly versus 22H1, and my Asus motherboards have their XMP or Expo profiles enabled, an aggressive fan profile setup, so we're running at 95 to 100% fan speed under load, and I also disabled Asus MCE or multi-core enhancement because it can result in inconsistent test results. Intel has power delivery profiles for 14th gen that set ICC max limits to 307 amps, or 400 amps, but the ASUS Z790 Hero just goes with an unlimited ICC max setting, which bumps it to 511.75 amps. But none of that really matters because you'll hit a temperature limit well before a power limit, as we're about to see. Here's a quick look at CPU temps for the 14900K during my Handbrake testing. As you can see, five of the P cores got into the red during this 2-minute test, with three of them hitting 100C. The cores that are most likely to hit high temps are the cores that are boosting to 5.8 or 6 GHz, which is understandable, but it should be noted that those 6 GHz advertised frequencies are only achievable temporarily, and I hit 100C in both compute and gaming tests alike. Hey, at least that allowed me to confirm that per-core thermal throttling works, so the 14900K is at least slightly more graceful at dealing with these situations than the 13900K. Here are some power draw numbers, including the peak CPU package power draw across all tests, and the system power draw for Blender and in a couple games, which for those results also includes the power draw for the RTX 4090. All else aside, the 7950X3D is still way more efficient than the 13900K or 14900K, which is largely attributable to it being a 5-nanometer CPU. Versus Intel's chips, which are still based on Intel 7 manufacturing, which you can classify as a 10-nanometer node based on transistor density. And now it's time for the benchmarks, starting with Cinebench R23 using all cores and threads. The 14900K won this test, coming in about 2.5% faster than the 13900K, while the 7950X3D was about 5% slower. Here are the single-thread scores, where Intel already had a healthy lead, and the 6 GHz peak clock speed gave the 14900K just a bit of a bump for a 2.7% win over the 13900K. CPUMark is part of the Passmark performance test, now updated to version 11, and in the multi-threaded tests, the 14900K was able to edge out the 13900K by less than 1%, but both lost to the Ryzen flagship, which beat the new Intel CPU by 4.4%. In CPUMark's single-threaded test, the 14900K again scored a win. It was 3.4% faster than last gen. It's also more than 10% in front of the 7950X3D here. Blender 3.6 is next, which is a free and open source 3D creation suite. The Open Data 3.1 test provides a samples per minute score across three test scenes, Monster, Junk Shop, and Classroom. The 7950X3D took the win here, just shy of 10% faster than either Intel CPU, both of which performed in an eerily similar way, almost like they're practically the same CPU or something. Next, we have video transcoding via Handbrake, processing a 150 megabit H.264 4K video down to 1080p with the fast preset. The encoding speed is shown as a frame rate, and once again, the 14900K was about 0.9% faster than the 13900K, outputting 77.7 frames per second. That's a 9.3% win over the 7950X3D. Moving on to V-Ray by Chaos Group, it makes photoreal imagery and animations. The 7950X3D's score of 28,157 allowed it to stay on top of the 14900K by a healthy 11.2%. The Corona renderer is available standalone or as a plugin for 3D Studio Max or Cinema 4D, and we're looking at time to render, so lower is better. Not too much to explain here, what with a 2-second difference in times and identical performance from the Intel CPUs yet again. Rounding out our compute tests, we have 7-zip testing basic file compression and decompression. In the compression test, all procs were around 170,000 MIPS, with the 14900K coming in 5.7% faster than the 7950X3D and 0.4% faster than the 13900K. In decompression, Ryzen chips have done well historically, and the 7950X3D continued that trend, hitting 250,367 MIPS for a 22% win versus the 14900K. Moving on to gaming benchmarks, where I've tested all the games at 1080p and 4K, except 3DMark and Civ 6, and again, our GPU is NVIDIA's RTX 4090 Founders Edition. This is 3DMark times by Extreme, a synthetic DirectX 12 benchmark from 3DMark, and here the RTX 4090's graphics score did not fluctuate much at all between the three CPUs. They're all within about 1% with a slight edge for Intel. The CPU test is a better comparison, and here the 14900K took a 4.4% win over the 13900K and a 2.8% lead on the 7950X3D. Please note that these 3DMark results are not included in my cumulative performance numbers. The rest of the games are, though, starting with Far Cry 6, and at 4K, the 14900K managed to lose to its last-gen counterpart, although it was only by 1-2%, and we are very GPU-bound here, so let's look at 1080p, where the 14900K still lost by about 2 frames. I reran these tests to confirm, and while the 7950X3D ultimately took the win here, it's another symptom of how similar these Intel CPUs are. The results can look like this. Next, we have Shadow of the Tomb Raider. Let's see if the 14900K can... Nope, Nope, no it can't. It was still ever so slightly slower than the 13900K. This is unfair though. These are 4K results, they're GPU limited, so here is 1080p, and oh thank goodness, the new CPU has earned its 14th gen title with a 0.8% win over last gen. Of course, the 7950X3D hit almost 300 FPS here, leaving the 14900K 11% behind, so there's that too. In Cyberpunk 2077 at 4K, we once again had very similar average frame rates, with the 14900K eking out about a 1% win. When we switched to 1080 this time though, the 14900K at last took the lead in a substantive sort of way, if you consider 2% to be substantive. It was at least almost 6% ahead of the 7950X3D. Horizon Zero Dawn is next, using the Favor Quality preset, and the 7950X3D was slightly ahead at 4K by about 3.5%. In the 1080 results, Intel's 14900K gained some ground on the 7950X3D, beating the 13900K by 2.2%, but still wasn't able to pass up the competition. Continuing on to Starfield, a new title in my mix, which was running with the high graphics preset at 4K, that meant about 83 to 85 FPS out of the RTX 4090, with the 13900K once again saying, "I'm not dead yet," and scoring a slight win. At 1080, the 14900K managed to jump into the lead, 131.3 FPS, which was 1.2% faster than the 13900K and 10% faster than the 7950X3D. My final title is Civilization VI Gathering Storm, and here I used the Gathering Storm AI benchmark. This test isn't included in my final roundup, but I wanted to show a situation where CPU capabilities are determined by AI turn time rather than how many frames it can squeeze out of a GPU. It didn't turn out very exciting though, with all three CPUs getting a turn time of just over 25 seconds. And now for the best part of my benchmark review videos, where I reduce much data down to a few summary comparisons. I wish this slide was less boring, but here are my compute and gaming results across all multi-threaded tests for compute, and including the 5 games minus 3DMark and Civ 6 for gaming. We're using the 13900K as the zero point. Somehow the 14900K was slightly slower than the 13900K at 4K, although those are very GPU-bound tests. At 1080, it was faster, as Intel intended, but only by 1%. And for compute, about a 1.2% boost, with the 7950X3D taking the win thanks to strong performance in Blender, V-Ray, and 7-Zip. But let's also add the CPU prices, because it's nice to see everything on one page. I am using the current retail price for existing CPUs, not MSRP, and I couldn't help but note that Intel couldn't quite muster the courage to charge $650 at launch for the 14900K, as they did with the 12900K a couple years back. That, at least, places it in a competitive position, given that it couldn't quite take a commanding lead with raw performance. But what can I say to wrap up? Well, I'm very glad that AMD and Intel are so close to each other in terms of gaming and compute performance. It does not make for a very dramatic or exciting benchmark reveal. The 14900K exists. It's priced somewhat competitively, it's slightly better than last gen, and otherwise it was quite underwhelming. But Intel could only do so much with a mid-tier refresh. Practically speaking though, the 14900K doesn't have a lot to offer anyone with a 12th to 13th gen CPU already in their system as an upgrade. Likewise, gamers who are building a new rig can save a lot by going with something like a 5800X3D or a 7800X3D, which offer comparable gaming performance for way less money. If you need a lot of compute power, you'd probably do better with a 7950X, and for mixed use, the 7950X3D would be my recommendation for now, with the added bonus that AMD's Socket AM5 platform is a new platform with future generations of CPUs promised, whereas Intel's current LGA 1700 platform is effectively end of life after the 14th gen launch completes in early 2024. It will be replaced by Arrow Lake and LGA 1851 motherboards, which should feature both new CPU architecture and a die shrink in mid to late 2024. Okay, that's all I have to say on the 14900K for now. I hope you enjoyed this review. I have closing things to say, like hit the thumbs up button on your way out if you enjoyed this video. Check out my store at paulshardware.net for shirts and other cool stuff you can buy. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and stay tuned for lots more content coming at you real soon. We'll see you all in the next video.